It's bright under the cleaves. Hi, it's Knox. Episode 2 of the history of iPhone art, photography, and video, otherwise known as iPhoneism. I'm still figuring this out. I'm using the lights tonight. I don't know if I'll use them again, but just trying it out with the backdrop here in the pixelation studio. I thought I would just talk about the first couple of years of the iPhone. We're gonna play little snippet of the video from Steve Jobs introducing the iPhone at Macworld in 2007. It's really funny. Interestingly, he does not mention the camera. It's the iPod, the phone, and the browser. That was so important. So anyway, that was 2007. And I'll just play the clip right now. And so.
Today, we're introducing three revolutionary products of this class. The first one is a widescreen iPod with touch controls. The second is a revolutionary mobile phone. And the third is a breakthrough internet communications device. So, three things: a widescreen iPod with touch controls, a revolutionary mobile phone, and a breakthrough internet communications device. An iPod, a phone, and an internet communicator. An iPod, a phone. Are you getting it? These are not three separate devices. This is one device. And we are calling it iPhone. Today, Apple is going to reinvent the phone. And here it is. Now, actually, here it is, but we're going to leave it there for now. So, before we get into it, let me talk about a category of things. The most advanced phones are called smartphones, so they say. And they typically combine a phone plus some email capability, plus they say it's the internet, sort of the baby internet, into one device, and they all have these.
Okay, so that was great fun, wasn't it? I mean, incredible, world-changing product, and Steve Jobs at his salesman best, and you could feel the excitement in the crowd. I get a kick out of watching this this video. I've watched it any number of times in the past. It's almost 13 years now, isn't it? So that was 2007. Now, what happened shortly thereafter, on April 21st, two iPhone pictures appeared on Flickr, and here they are. No one knows who took the pictures. No one knows who posted the pictures. Probably the same person, right? Nobody knows who's in the pictures, but they were taken down almost immediately. Now, on June 29th, 2007, the iPhone was released, and Apple sold 270,000 in the first 2 days. And they ended up selling 1,389,000 of them in 2007 total. And of course, they transforming the telephone business, the mobile device business, and without realizing it, they were transforming the photography world as well. Lines formed days in advance of the release of the Apple, the iPhone, and all the stores were mobbed. Monkey has to get in at the action here. Come here and say hi. I know you did last time. Come here, you little goofball. Come here. This is Monkey Blue. He's been around for a few months. I was bottle feeding him a few months ago, but now he's a teenager, and he is feeling very feisty. We're gonna be going to the vet pretty soon. So, anyway, so let me read this here, make it a little easier. January 8th, the first of 2008, so we've skipped ahead a few months, 2008, the first iPhone photo app was released, Camera Pro. On May 8th, the iPhone became the most popular mobile phone camera on Flickr. Interestingly, by the time I launched Pixels in late 2009, there were still only 700,000 pictures, iPhone pictures on Flickr. Let's see here, July 11th, 2008, the iPhone 3, so we skipped ahead, we're in 2008 now, we left 2007 behind. The iPhone 3G is released. So I had to stop for a minute and clean up the tea. I mean, Monkey pulled the tablecloth and the cup just went pew. But that's what kitties do, right? So on July 11th, the iPhone 3G was released. A little over a month later, the iPhone breezed past the dominant point-and-shoot camera, the Canon EOS Digital Rebel, as the number one camera on Flickr. That was the middle of 2008. Pretty amazing. On September 29, the iconic app Camera Bag was released. And on November 15th, 2008, Lynn Evans launched iPhonography.com, the first website devoted solely to iPhone photography, and ultimately introducing a new word into our shared global lexicon. And we will be having an interview with Glenn in a future episode, but he was the man, he's the original guy, saw what was happening. And he had this great blog, it lasted until late 2012. App reviews, featured artists, all kinds of stuff. He was ahead of everybody, and did a great job proselytizing and exposing hundreds of thousands, if not millions of people to iPhonography, and coined the term too, of course. So anyway, in 2008, Apple sold 11,625,000 iPhones. And now we get to 2009, which is when things really started to happen. Things started to coalesce, and the app development, the phone, the awareness of the what was happening with the phone as far as photography goes, and all sorts of groups began to be created on Flickr. The 3GS came out at June 19, yeah, and that was a quantum leap with the camera, I remember. And on September 22nd, Chase Jarvis released the classic and now iconic app BestCam. And here are some samples of what BestCam could do. It wasn't much. I mean, there were like about 10 different filters, and you could, you know, you could do one and then maybe do another on top of it. I mean, I spent hours fiddling with it, doing that. And then also I got Lo-Fi, another app we will discuss. Just a shame that Lo-Fi disappeared with the advent of iPhone 4. And but anyway, so yeah, very rudimentary, but it was something. It was very intuitive. It certainly, you know, paved the way for, you know, a lot of future apps in terms of how it worked, in terms of the intuitiveness. That it was not a production tool, it was a more of an art tool. And he also coined the phrase, the best camera is the one you have with you. And I've seen a number of people kind of use it themselves without attributing it to him. That was Chase Jarvis, quite a guy. I've never met him, a very interesting guy. And on September 30th, Marty Yonick launched his great iPhonography blog, lifeinlofi.com. And it was kind of similar to Glenn's. Marty, for years, just did these incredible app reviews, and he really covered the whole scene in a way that, I still go to that website to check on things. And he's not as active anymore at all. But we stay in touch. And that site took off too. Now, on October 4th, something really important happened. That's the morning I woke up on one sunny Sunday, not sunny at all, drizzly Sunday morning. And I'm laying on the couch. I'd fallen asleep on the couch. I had three cats. I'm sure at least one of them was sleeping with me. And I thought, you know what? I think I'm going to check out some of these camera apps. So I got up and, you know, downloaded a couple. I didn't even make a cup of coffee yet. And I got BestCam and Toy Camera. I think that was it. I think, yeah. And I was instantly entranced and obsessed. And I just took pictures for hours. I had been taking pictures with my iPhone every day before that of my cat, Baby. She even had her own blog called babiesnohelp.com. But after I got the couple of camera apps, that's all I wanted to do. And you know, then a little bit later, I showed them to my then girlfriend, Maya Panos, and the apps. And, you know, like about a week later, she showed me some of her pictures. And I've still told this story many times. And when I saw what she was doing compared to what I was doing, and, you know, here's a little slideshow here, you know, happening. I'd already felt that we were dealing with a new art form with the iPhone and the apps, a new emergent art form. Maya's work confirmed it. And so basically about a month and a half passed, and Maya and I were both just obsessed with taking pictures with the iPhone. And we stopped in one day to see Ray Douglas at the Georgie Gallery in Berkeley near the Claremont Hotel. And I got friendly with Ray, and I said, "Hey, Ray, how would you like to happens all the time I live on a weird street. Trailer park up there filled with junkies and prostitutes. Village of tweaker squatters over here. This building's protected by a well-known outlaw motorcycle gang, which I won't name. Monkey! I'm trying to do a history of iPhone art and photography. Anyway, we stopped in to see Ray, and I said, hey, Ray, how would you like to do a show of iPhone photography? And he said, sure, you'll have to curate it. I said, okay. So I, you know, we went, Maya and her daughter, Sophia, and I went and had breakfast up at Rick and Ann's there. And when I got home, I Googled juried gallery show iPhone photography. I could not find one, like anywhere. I called Ray up the next day. I said, you know, if we're fast, we can be the first people to ever do an iPhone photography show. And he said, okay, and he bounced a show, and he called me back. He said, we can open on January 30th. I said, it's done. And I started working on the website that day, because I knew we had to put out a call for submissions. We needed a website. And I called a friend of mine, a political consultant in Washington, D.C., and I told him what I was doing. He goes, oh, great, we'll do this then. Go get some venture capital, this and that. And this was probably 11 o'clock in the morning by the end of this time. And I said, yeah, right on. And so for the rest of the, about six more hours, all I could think about is what kind of website do I need to build to appeal to venture capitalists. And all of a sudden I realized I wasn't having any fun anymore. And I called him up and I said, Ralph, the IPO is off. No IPO. I'm not having any fun anymore. And I don't want to do this if I'm not having fun. He said, okay. I totally get it. And so that was kind of my motto. I was only going to do pixels if it wasn't even pixels at that time. I was only going to do it if I was having fun. And I'll tell you, I wish I'd stuck to that over the years. We'll talk about that later. But the next day or two, I was talking to Ray. I said, well, what should we call the show? And he said, pictures at an exhibition. And I said, pixels at an exhibition. That's where it came from. Ray is a great guy. I got to hand it to him for agreeing to do the show. Not much else happened it did. So I had the site up launched on 29th. I started doing the calls for submission to Flickr groups and sent an email to Marty and Glenn Evans and stuff like the other bloggers that were around announcing the show. But on December 9, Hipstamatic launched, and you know, everybody knows Hipstamatic, and they had this totally phony backstory about some brothers that invented a toy camera type thing, and they discovered these cameras, and they wanted to replicate the look of what these cameras did, and you know, totally bogus, but they took off, and it's incredible what happened with Hipstamatic. It drove me crazy for years because I got so many bad pictures with Hipstamatic, and they all looked the same to me because of the green and the mottled and the big thick black square border and stuff like that. But man, people loved it, and we'll talk about Hipstamatic in depth at some other time. I've gotten to like Hipstamatic, and I've seen some phenomenal work done with Hipstamatic. So it's just another tool. But in the beginning, it was very limited, and so let's see what else. Okay, so in there, I was building the, I was looking, I one thing I do remember, December of 2009, when we first put out the call for submissions, you know, we wanted $5, and we got 3 submissions after about, I don't know how many days. And I said to Ray, let's not have an entry fee, and he said, okay. So that then the submissions started to come in even more, so that was good. Also, I discovered an article with Sion Falana, who was, I didn't know at the time, was like the top of the pyramid on Flickr groups. He was a street photographer from New York City and did some wonderful work. And they interviewed him about his photography, and I remember he mentioned in this interview, it's probably the first ever interview of an iPhone photographer. I don't know if it could even be found now. In fact, a lot of the material that I'm referring to tonight, I can't find anymore. This is all from iPhotographer magazine. An issue that I put together 4 or 5 years ago. A lot of the source material I can't find, so I had to resurrect iPhotographer so I could access this stuff, these pictures that you're seeing and stuff. But anyway, Sion talked about altering his pictures on his computer, and it really affected me. I thought, no, this. We can't allow that. That can't be. There's something special here with just using the phone with the apps. And so I left a comment saying, I'm sorry, but Mr. Falana's pictures would not be eligible for my contest. Now, they didn't know me from any, Adam. I mean, I was totally unknown, but I know that led to all kinds of stuff in 2010. It was a real battle about off-device editing. But I was the first one to drew the line. No off-device editing. We keep the pictures on the phone or later the iPad. And that's, you know, and I remember some guy, another blogger called me, well, we need to, how do we define, you know, iPhonography? I said, it's defined by the device. It's shot on the iPhone. It's apped on the iPhone. That's it. And anyway, Apple confirmed that later in 2010, and we will get to that also. I've really rambled. I don't know how long I've been going on, but on December 28th, we got a write-up in the New York Times. A little short write-up in the tech section, not the art section, about our gallery show of iPhone photography. It was very exciting, I have to say. And then, of course, at that point, the pictures started pouring in, felt like they were pouring in. Our deadline for the show was January 15. So 2009 was a seminal year. It was starting to build. And, you know, as a camera, it was taken off on Flickr. There were a few apps that, you know, were exciting. I mean, whatever else, you know, Hipstamatic was exciting. We'd never seen anything like this before. Same with BestCam, same with Toy Camera. And then Lo-Fi, one of my favorites, that I still a favorite of mine. So that was what was happening. Now in January, a bunch of others, well, I'm gonna cut it off here in 2009, but it was a seminal year. I'm gonna put in a little gallery here of some of the pictures we got, the early pictures we got for the contest. You can get an idea of what we were looking at. And I'll do some more of that in my next episode, which we'll talk about January. So anyway, this is Knox. publisher of Pixels at an exhibition.com. Used to be the art of the iPhone. And now I'm thinking about calling it the home of iPhoneism. I finally decided I like the term iPhoneism. And I'll talk about that some other. There's a lot to talk about. And I'm going to be putting these out on a weekly basis, or strive to. And I hope in it, I can convey the excitement of those early years and what was going on, and the new app, as the apps came in, and the new artists, and it was just wonderful. But we'll be interviewing Marty and Glenn and Sion, and lot of great stuff coming. So that's it for tonight. Hope you enjoyed it, and until next time, this is Knox over and out. Hey Monkey, come here. You wanna come say goodnight? I guess not. He's over on the easy chair. So, all right. Thanks, and see you next time.